two little fish and five loaves of bread and fed 5,000. I know you can do it. Oh, yeah. You went to the graveyard one day and told a dead man. One more time, because I know you can do it, Master.
Strength,
and my life shall be
strength like
and
no other.
We brought nothing
strength
to
like
world.
No other.
We can carry
to me.
The Lord gave.
You
the Lord
are my
away.
Strength. Strength like
be
no other.
The name
strength
of the Lord.
Like no other reaches to me. You are my strength, strength like no other, strength like no other reaches to me. Like no other, strength like no other reaches to me. You are my joy, joy like no other, joy like no other. To me, you are my joy, joy like no other, joy like no other reaches to me in the stillness of your grace. In the power of your name, you lift me up. You lift me up. In the fullness of your grace, in the power of your name, you lift me up. Strength like no other.
Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Strength like no other.
Strength like no other.
Reaches to me. You are my strength. Strength like no other. Strength like no other reaches to me in the stillness of your grace.
Stillness of your grace.
In the power of your name, you lift me up.
Thank you, Jesus.
You lift me up in the stillness of your grace, and in the power of your name, you lift me up. You lift me up.
Certainly, again, we offer to this family our deepest condolences and prayers that God will strengthen you in a mighty way, in a way that only God can do for us. As we continue with the celebration of life for Brother Leon Albert Goodwin, better known as what? Semp. All right. We shall continue with the program as the family has outlined it, opening hymn, Mr. Billy Jefferson, Old Testament, Deacon Douglas Hopkins, New Testament, Evangelist Diane Stewart, prayer, Pastor Jerome Goodwin, and then musical selection, Miss Angela Bryant, in that order. God bless you.
Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. I'm crying, Savior, oh, Savior, hear my. Savior, oh, Savior. My humble cry.
Greet all you this day in the name of Jesus unto the Goodwin family. As I read a portion of the Old Testament, the 23rd Psalm, always been a great comfort to me in time of sadness and trouble in heart. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leadeth me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley, the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, thou comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me, even in the presence of my enemy. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'll dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May God bless each and every one here today in the name of Jesus. Thank you,
greetings in the name of Jesus. I come to you with the New Testament reading, 1 Thessalonians, the 4th chapter, the 13th verse through the 13th through the 18th and 16th verses. And regarding the question, friends, thou hast come up about what happens to those already dead and buried. We don't want you in the dark any longer. First off, you must not carry on over them like people who have nothing to look forward to, as if the grave were the last word. Since Jesus died and broke loose from the grave, God will most certainly bring back to life those who died in Jesus. And then this, we can tell you with complete confidence, we have the Master's word on it, that when the Master come again to us, those of us who are still alive will not get a jump on the dead and leave them behind. In actual fact, they will be ahead of us. The Master himself will give the command, the archangel thunder, God's trumpet blast. He'll come down from heaven, and the dead in Christ will rise. They will go first. Then the rest of us who are still alive at the time will be caught up with them unto the clouds to meet the Master. Oh, we will be walking on air. And then there will be one huge family reunion with the Master. So reassure one another with these words. I have read the word of God for the people of God, and this has come from the Message Bible.
Savior. Oh, Savior, do not pass us by. Why I am calling, do not pass me by. Father, in the name of Jesus, we have seen and experienced so much death, Lord. It has not eluded any of us. And it has seemed to rear his head a lot lately, bringing to pass your word that says, no man knows the day, the time or the hour. Then you also pen in your word, what would man give in exchange for his soul? Father, it's us now calling on your name in a word of prayer. First, Lord, to say thank you, even in a time like this. I want to say thank you that you've allowed us to live up into this appointed time. And ask you, Father, in the name of Jesus, if you will, please, lay your anointed hands on our hearts. Lay your hands on our minds and our spirits, Lord Jesus. Lay your hands on this wife and, oh, Lord, son and daughters and grandchildren. Lay your hands, Father, on us, the family, Father, that we come to the point of life recognizing and realizing, Lord, that the time will also come for us that we've got to lay it down on this side and give an account for you to you on the other side. So, Father, any malice, any anger, Father, anything that be of sin that we have done up until this appointed time in our life, forgive us right now in the name of Jesus. Lord, touch the family like you've never touched before, Father. Move, Father, in their lives like you've never moved before. Father, if you don't mind, please, sir, will you save today? Will you sanctify today? Will you fill with your Holy Spirit today? Will you deliver and set free today, Father? Because, Lord, how many more times before we recognize and realize, Father, that death is real? Have your way in this place. Use your manservant like you've never used him before, Father. In the name of Jesus, anoint him from the very top of his head to the very sole of his feet, Father, the waving of his hand, Father, in the name of Jesus, that we all come to the realization, Father, that you are God and that you are God all by yourself. I'll be so grateful to give you the praise, give you the glory, and give you the honor. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. And family and friends said amen.
Let us all say amen and thanks to those who have participated on program thus far. Again, to this Goodwin and Hopkins families, Sister Betsy, God bless you and strengthen you and comfort you in a way that only He can do it for us. Amen. And also to the children and grandchildren. At this time, we will have remarks from Deacon Bobby Diamond, family friend, Mr. Adam Goodwin, grandson, Deacon June Brown, lifelong friend, then a musical selection, Mr. Billy Jefferson, and then we will have our words of comfort by the Reverend Flavian Coleman, pastor of the Antioch Baptist Church, homeboy, amen. Taylor's, Little Camden, Arthur Town, Eddystone Cope, all in the house. Let us pray with him and for him as he shares with us from the Word of God.
Amen. To Reverend Lewis and pulpit associates, to the family and to the friends, give me a pleasure, privilege and a pleasure to speak over my friends. See, we call him Simp. That's all I ever call him, Simp. You know, I met Simp when he was a little boy. I went to Taylor School in the first grade, and I was a friend to his sister, Jessie Mae. We went to school together at Perrin Thomas School, and we would have to walk by the house every day. Simp, Rag Mop, and all them fellas, they'd be out there playing, and Ding-a-ling, all them guys. You know, I've been knowing Simp all my life, but as he grew up, he started playing the sports, and we followed the baseball, the football, the basketball, and all that stuff. And after the years passed by, so Simp came down, moved down across my neighborhood and across the road, and got a job at U.S. Textile. I was working at U.S. Textile, and I was coming to work one morning, and Simp was walking up the road. And I picked him up. He said, I said, man, what you? He said, you know, I just moved down here. And he said, I got to get me a car, man. I got to get transportation to get to the job. We started talking. I said, well, why? I said, that shouldn't be a problem. I said, I'm working here. I live across the road. Nelson, he working here. He live across the road. I said, that shouldn't be a problem. He hook up with us. We take care of that. And ever since that, he never forget that, the favor that we did for him. He said, man, that released me a lot, man. Y'all do that for me. That's how we got close. So he came to work, and we just got close and close and close. Simp was a guy, he didn't take no back seat, if y'all know him. He was a great father. And, you know, everything he aimed to do, seemed to do, he did it. He'll do it. And we just got to be a close family. And, you know, on Fridays, we will be off work, get off work about 12 o'clock. They like to play, shoot basketball. He had all his, got his fellas there. All his buddies came there and worked with guys we played basketball with, off of Valley Park, all those guys. They played basketball. And sometime on Fridays, we get off, they go play, we go play. They'll play basketball, I would. I'll be with them, you know, and they were good, real good. And you know, if you know Simp, you know how Simp rolls. Let's go, let's go. Anybody ever play basketball with Simp, stand up. Well, y'all know what I'm talking about. So they got together and they would go play, and they want me to kind of keep things kind of straight, who can shoot the most points and all that kind of stuff. So I did. So finally, I said, man, y'all so good, man. Y'all guys so good. I said, y'all got to get in this commercial league we got here, man. We had a commercial league, but we didn't have nobody to play in the league. So I said, Simp, I said, you WAP and Papa Dean and all y'all boys, y'all can get this thing rolling. So we finally got it going. He said, well, we got to have somewhere to practice. I said, well, we'll find a place for y'all to practice. So we finally found a Olympia High School. They let us go up there and practice. So they go up there, they would practice. They were real good, man. They got good. And Simp said, all right, we got to move the thing on now. Well, Frank, Simp, Wop, Papa Dean, all those guys, you know how they roll. Simp said, all right, we got to make it happen. So I told the boss, I said, we got everything set up now, so we can go ahead and get this league set up. So it was a commercial league. And I'm going to tell you something. When they got in that commercial league, boy, they turned that out. Papa Dean, Wop, all them, some of those guys were shooting something like 20 some points per person. And we had coaches, and I was one of the coaches. I kept the book. And Sim said, all right, you keep the book. I want you to keep a special page on me now. Because he said, Papa Dean think he can outshoot me. I'm going to show him something. And Wop think he can outshoot me. I'm going to show you. You keep my page. I said, okay, I'll keep your page. So we started playing, and I don't know if y'all remember this guy. He's a NBC spokesman now, Steve Konecki. Anybody know him? He played along with us. Boy, he could shoot it. And Simp was right along with him. Simp, the harder you shoot, the harder I'm going to shoot. So, man, we got in that commercial league. And I got Henry back there. Henry, you about to stand up, Henry. Henry was good with me. Henry was there. We got in that commercial league, and they won nothing but championship. One night, I think Papa Dean had 30 points. Simp had about 35, and Wop had the 30s. And they won that game. So we had another game. And they was in competition with each other. That's why they got so great. Simp had 40 points. He came and asked me, he said, how many points I got? I said, Simp, you got 40. 40, he said, that ain't enough. He said, I'm going to shoot 50. And he sure did. He went and shot 50 points. And we got so good, we went 3 championships, and they shut the league down because couldn't nobody beat them. Now, these are facts. And we didn't get enough recognition. Simpson, man, don't tell them where I'm at. He said, man, I'll shoot this ball. He said, I'll shoot the cover off. Some had a, where they shooting 3 points now? Some had a jumper. Those guys know, y'all know. He had a jump shot. He could get in that corner. 3 or 4 people built him. They couldn't stop him no kind of way. And that's the part I know. I could sit up there and talk all day about Simp. But see, Simp was like, see, he was my little brother. He called me my big brother. You're my big brother, man. He always say, man, you're a good man. If I call Simp and talk to Sam, I'd have to talk 2 hours. He said, you're my big brother. I said, yeah, well, man, that's how we grow up, you know? So I'm going to cut it off right here. I said, to the family. He was my friend. And Frank, Simp didn't meet us. You wasn't a stranger to Simp, because if things weren't right with you, he'd let you know. And if you got to be his friend, you're his friend. Thank you.
Hey everybody, my name is Adam. A grandson of Mr. Leon Goodwin. He was more than my granddad, he was like my dad. Amen. You know, he raised me up from a baby basically to a man. And if anybody know anything about me, they know my grandparents everything to me. And my granddad, he was a tough man, real tough man, real tough on me growing up. You know, I used to think, like, man, cut me a break, dude. Yeah, he was real tough on me growing up. He's no nonsense guy. And I was talking about basketball. When I was a little boy, I used to think I can beat him. When I got around 11, 12, he used to think I could beat him. We went up to Hyde Park one day, and man, he skunked me like 12-2. Yeah. He had his mid-range jump shot was, that thing was wet. Yeah, he didn't miss no jumpers on me. And my granddad, man, I'm gonna miss him. Ain't nobody like him, man. Nah, you know, growing up, me and my brothers, our cousins, all of us, we were like his kids. You know, he couldn't tell us no difference whether grandkids or his own kids. He was on us tough, though. The most important thing that I take from him is, he really taught me how to be a man. And he pretty much forced me to join the Marines. I didn't want to do it. He made me do it. He said, "Hey, son, you gotta grow up. You gotta get up out of my house, man." And so you gotta grow up. And
that's the old school there.
Yeah, but I thank him for that. It helped me, give me a push to, do the things I needed to do to become a man.
And,
without him. I don't know how it would have turned out. I really don't know. And Mom, I know you're gonna miss him. I'm gonna miss him just as much as you are. And I could go on and on, but my mind is a little cloudy right now. Last, I just want to say special thanks to my brother Adrian. I really appreciate you, man. You was there with him. You was there with him. I know he hitting you up on the walkie-talkie, Adrian. I know he was hitting you up all day and night, man, to come. And I appreciate it from the bottom of my heart, man, because I wasn't able to help you guys out with him like that. But he's gonna be missed. But his legacy, living through me and everybody else, it will live on. And
yes, sir.
Yeah. Just thank everybody for showing up, and we love y'all.
To the pulpit.
Yes, sir.
To the Goodwin family.
Amen.
I thank the Goodwin family for choosing me to say a few words about my brother.
Amen.
See, this is hard. But me and this man went back a long ways. I've known him since the fourth grade. We used to walk together from Edisto Court to the schoolhouse. Played in the elementary school for a long time. Went to high school, still were together. What cemented our friendship was when his brother Big Dooley married my sister. then the friendship became not only a friend, but a solid brother. Because I loved that man. When he had, I had.
Amen.
When I got in the car to go somewhere, he went. Never left behind. We got ready to go by the foot of the station stand and get a soda. He got a soda.
Amen.
You guess him, the cup I emptied. So don't worry about it, bro. I got him.
Amen.
Loved him. Class of Booker T. Washington, 63. Will y'all please stand? Whole class, 63. Thank y'all. Thank y'all for coming. I know Simp was here and saying he would love to see y'all too, because he loved Booker T. Washington, and especially the class of Booker T. Washington. So I'm sure glad so many of y'all showed up today.
Amen.
Now Simp was not what you call a church man all the time. I wasn't either. Until now. And that took a lot of doing. But Simp always tell me that I love God.
All right.
I love God. You know, he didn't go every Sunday like I did, a lot of us in here did, but he loved God. And he was a great family man, took care of his family. And the gentleman just said a while ago, he talked so much about basketball, there ain't much I can say more about basketball. But he called him Simp, he called him Sugar. The reason why he called him Sugar, because he was so sweet. He could shoot that jump shot, man. He shoot that thing, man, and I mean, he made it whistle. He could shoot, that's why everybody called him Sweet. And he called him Sugar, because he could shoot. And I was playing with him in the afternoon. We would play, the sun was going down. And the only way I would ever win a game is when I make him tired. I was a little bit quicker than him because he had asthma. He would get sick and sit on the sideline. Then I'd go and score with 3 or 4 points. I holler out, I won. But the only way I would win, he'd let me win. But he could shoot that jump shot. And he always loved the Boston Celtics. It was his favorite team. He loved the Boston Celtics. You can hear Larry Bird right now. Shoot a Larry. I told that white boy I could shoot. Shoot a Larry. And Larry Bird could shoot it too. And his favorite team was the Atlanta Braves. He loved the Atlanta Braves. I ain't gonna take too long. It's getting late in the afternoon. The sun's going down. I just want to say one thing to all of us here.
Yes, sir.
Simp has paid his dues.
I know.
His debt is paid. We here, we have to do the same thing Simp did. Lay our body down. I'm going to say to everyone out here, everyone, if you're not saved, Lord have mercy.
Hallelujah.
If you're not saved, get saved. Before you leave this place today.
Amen.
Because you don't know when, or where, or how he's coming back. But he's coming back. And you better be prepared. So if you're not saved, get saved.
Hallelujah.
Have a blessed day.
As we prepare our hearts and our minds to hear the word of God, you know, the Bible tells us in everything give thanks.
Amen.
Even in situations like these, we have to be thankful. You know, and just as it was said earlier, you know, today is Simp's day. We don't know when our day is coming.
Amen.
And death in the last couple of weeks has been surrounding our community, the community where I grew up. You know, it has hit Little Camden, it has hit Arthurtown, it has hit Taylor's area. But we all know that no matter where we live on this earth, that we have to prepare ourselves for where we're going to live after we leave this earth. And not to be before you long, but I'm going to ask that you guys help me with this song. I sang it for the last two funerals I was at. Remember my son telling me one day we had a thing at the church called Rep Your Team, and he wanted the Gamecocks. I got him a jersey, and we were heading down. He said, well, Dad, you didn't get anything. I said, yeah, because I don't have a team. He said, yes, you do. I said, well, who is my team? He said, Bostick and Tompkins. Because I go to a lot of funerals, but that's what happens when you know a lot of people. And I'm going to do this song, and then I'm going to sit down and let my cousin Flavian do what God has sent him to do for us today. Amen. When I've gone my last mile, oh Lord, and I can't. Just let the words of my heart, meditation, of my heart, be accepted. Yeah, yes. When I've gone my last mile, oh Lord, and I can't. Just let the word meditation be accepted. Yeah, yes. When I've sang my last song, oh Lord, and I can't. Just let the words, meditation, be accepted. Yeah, yes. When I've done the best that I can, oh Lord, and I can't. Just let the words, meditation, be accepted. Yeah, yes. Oh Lord, oh Lord.
Everybody say, everybody say, everybody say, Lord, everybody say. Everybody say amen. Everybody say amen. Lord. Early in the morning, amen. Early in the morning, amen. Early in the morning, Lord, even at the noonday. Even at the noonday, amen. Even at the noonday, Lord. Even in the midnight, amen. Even in the midnight, amen. Even in the midnight, Lord, amen, amen. God, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to stand before your people, to proclaim your words to your people. Father, we ask that thou would be with this family. Give them strength. Give them comfort. Give them peace. Bless your word, God, so that it would not return into your void, but that it will go and accomplish everything that you set for it to do. In Jesus' holy and righteous name. Amen.
Amen.
To this beloved Goodwin family, this wife and these children and grandchildren and other relatives, we're praying for you that God would grant you whatever you need in such a time like this. To the Booker T. Washington family and all of these other sports enthusiasts and people that are great in your own right, thank you for being here this day so that the family could see your love and support. I'm going to ask that all of the clergy would stand, those that are on the pulpit and those that are in the audience. Family, if you can just turn your head briefly and so that you can see these the laborers of the gospel that are praying for you. So much love and care.
Amen.
From the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verse 1. The Message Bible said, there's an opportune time to do things, a right time for everything on the earth. But the time that God has allotted us to share together this afternoon, the appointed time, the appointed time. Sisters and brothers, the great God that we serve has permitted and allowed all of us to come together for such a time like this to show this family how much we love them, how much we support them, and how much simp was love. From the time of his birth, if you look in your program, it has July the 15th, 1945, until God decided to take him home April the 15th, 2024. God permitted him to be with us for all those years. I believe if my mathematical calculations are correct, 77, it would have been 78. Is that right? 79. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. We all miss it sometime, don't we? Amen. And I guess that's why I never played ball. But in the span of time, from the time of his birth until God decided to call him home, look at the great God that we serve. Look at what God has done. He has permitted and allowed all of us to be a part of Simp's life in some way, shape, form, or fashion, and he has allowed Simp to be a part of all our lives. 57 years as a husband, He also had the blessed privilege of having the role of father and grandfather. And many of you in your conversations and in your remarks, you talked about how good of a basketball player he was. And no doubt he probably played many other sports too. But God allowed him to do all these things. So even at a time like this, even on today's day, we give God glory. We give him honor and we give him praise for the appointed time. God allows all of us to be born and he allows all of us to sojourn. And then at the appointed time, he calls us home. If you look on many of the tombstones that are in the cemetery, you'll see a birth date, you'll see a death date, but in between, you see a dash. That dash means that that's something in everything that you've done while you had the blessed opportunity to live. The appointed time grants us the time to love upon one another, to care for one another, to opportune in those roles that God permits us to operate in as a husband, as a father, as a grandfather, as a sports enthusiastic person, somebody that knows the game. All of us are blessed to live our lives in such a way that we can touch somebody else's life. That's what legacy is all about, that we touch somebody else's life while we pass this way. If all of us had the opportunity to come to the podium and to say a few things about Simp in 38. I was asking Sister Bessie, where did that 38 come from? And she said, well, he played ball out there in the community with the younger people, and they gave him 38.
Yes, sir. Come on. Yes, sir.
But that's the great God that we serve, that enables us as we sojourn this way to touch somebody's life. That's what a hymnologist said. If I can help somebody with a word, if I can help somebody with a song, if I can help somebody as I'm traveling along, then my living will not be in vain. God doesn't want any of our living to be in vain. So as he blesses us to operate in the dash between birth and death, bless somebody's life. Tell somebody how much you love them. Tell them how much you care. Love upon them while you have the time. Because you see, all of us, family and friends, all of us have an appointed time. We remember the day of our birth. Somebody told us that you were born on this day. And somebody else will talk about the day that we left. But while we have the blessed opportunity, let's do all that we can for somebody right now. Love upon them. It's important that they remember us and what we did to leave behind for the next generation that comes along behind us. The Bible says a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. It's not about us. It's about those that are coming along behind us. So the appointed time is right now. What has God blessed you with that you can use to bless humanity? Has he given you a word that you can share with them? Has he given you resources that you can share with them? Has he done something for you that you can do for somebody else? I'm sure that all of us in here have a story of our own that we can tell. We can share stories about Simp and how he blessed us in such a way that will enable us to bless somebody else. But it doesn't stop here. It lives on. So I commend you this day. I appreciate the fact that you've talked about his basketball playing. I appreciate the fact that you talked about his three-pointers. I appreciate the fact that he did this and he did that. But what has he done? How has he contributed to your life that you could make somebody else's life better? What has he left you with? That's what it's all about. Being able to receive the blessings of God and bless somebody else as you pass along. In order to be good and to be a good leader, you got to be a good follower. In order to be a mentor, you first have to be a mentee. So In other words, if God has poured all of this into us, we need to pour it all into somebody else. What will they say about you at the appointed time? Will they talk about how much you loved and how much you cared and how much you gave and what you've done as you sojourn in this life? What will they say about you at the appointed time? Because all of us have one. And we're even living in the appointed time right now. Unbeknown to us, we didn't know that God would call all of us together, Taylors, Luke Camden, Arthur Town, Edisto Court. We didn't know. But God knew. Because he knows us. He knows us better than we know ourselves. We didn't know that we would operate in these roles in which we operate in this life. But while God has blessed us so, let's be able to be a blessing to somebody else. So remember the stories of how you engaged and interacted with him. Remember the words that he said to you. Remember maybe how he told you that he was sorry and how he loved you and how he cared for you. Remember his sports. Remember his team. Remember, remember, remember. Why? Because it's the important time. It's the appointed time as now. Don't let your living be in vain. Don't let your giving be in vain. Whatever we can do, family and friends, as we sojourn in this life, know that the appointed time is right now. The Bible teaches us to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. So even though he's no longer with us in bodily form, God has permitted us at the appointed time to yet still be here. That's the blessed opportunity that we can get closer to God, we can serve God, we can love God, we can do what the Lord would have us to do. But the appointed time is not only to love God, but love humanity as well. God bless you. God keep you. Know that as we go along in this life, it's the appointed time. We're praying for you. All of you, we love you, we appreciate you, we thank God for you in this appointed time, because at this season, God has allowed us to come together at such a time like this so that we can get closer to him and we can get closer to one another. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus for permitting all of us to serve you and serve humanity. Father, let us continue to be around this family. Enable us to pray for them. Tell them how much we love them, but not only tell them, show them as well. We know, Father, that most of the people, most of the crowds come before the service. And then after the service, you hardly ever see anybody. But Father, let us turn that thing around. And some of the same folks need to show up afterwards as they did before. It's the appointed time. God, thank you for our time together. Use us in such a way that we would bless all humanity and give you glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hallelujah.
The directors will come at this time.
right now. Lord, if you don't do it, it just won't be done. I said, Lord, if you don't do it, yes, oh, it just won't be done. Lord, if you don't do it, it just won't be done. But Lord, Lord, do it for me. Oh, Lord, right now. Ezekiel said he saw him at the meal in the middle of a wheel. Yes. But John talked about him, oh, yes, in the book of the seven seals. Oh, yes. Some call them the Rose of Sharon. Oh, yes. Others call him the Prince of Peace. But I call Jesus my rock. Well, Ezekiel said he saw him, oh, yes, at the wheel in the middle of a wheel. Oh, yes. But John talked about him, oh, yes, in the book of the seven seals. Oh, yes. They call him the Rose of Sharon. Oh, yes. They call him the Prince of Peace. Oh, yes. But I call Jesus my rock. They call him Jesus my rock. They call him Jesus my rock. Well, he's my ballet.